Good evening to one and all. We cordially invite all for health awareness talk on the benefits of medical ozone and chelation therapy in chronic diseases. It is organized by Miracle Wellness Clinic. Let us all rise for Tamil Thai Valtu. Dr. K. Arul, Chief Medical Officer, Miracle Wellness Clinic, to welcome the gathering.
It's my pleasure to welcome one and all for this amazing talk on benefits of medical ozone and chelation in chronic and degenerative disorders. We opened this Miracle Wellness Clinic in Pollachi 1.5 years back, and it's the brainchild of our chairman, Dr. M. Manikam. Till date, we have treated around 1,500 patients using high-dose vitamin C, ozone and other non-invasive procedures like rectal ozone and other things. Most of the patients who come to us at this stage, to our clinic, at stage 3 or 4, only very few who are afraid to undergo chemo or radiation or surgery, they come before attempting to go for any consultation with the oncologist or any other hospitals. And with them we have got very good results pertaining to their quality of life, and their daily routine works are done without any hindrance. Stage 3 and stage 4 also, we have got very good results. Patients become better in few sittings. Patients, one or two patients also a year, they have come to listen this. They will be, if you want, you can talk to them and find out all these things. I heard the name of Dr. Mahendran, but I couldn't meet him. I have been traveling around the world, been to Malaysia, but I never had a chance to meet you, sir. And that day when Dr. Sivasamy, we all became doctors after seeing him. I used to take my father to him regularly. And my uncle is also his patient. Then they told that such and such doctor has come from Malaysia, he wants to see that. I thought it's really a blessing in disguise. He came, we met him, then we discussed everything about all these therapies. Though he is a doctor professionally, gynecologist, was done, I'm a Royal College of Obstetrics and Gynecologist. He is into this therapy after seeing the benefits. Maybe for him or for his patients, he will be talking a lot about it. So I don't want to talk more than this. I'll request our chairman to say a few words. Based on that, then we'll listen to the amazing talk of Dr. Mahendran. Thank you.
Miracle Wellness Clinic is the brainchild of Dr. M. Manikam, the man who laid on initiative to establish a ozone wellness clinic on the outskirts of Pollachi. It reaps benefits to many localites and public across the southern part of Tamil Nadu. Now, we call upon Dr. M. Manikam, Chief Executive Officer, Miracle Wellness Clinic, to address the gathering.
Good evening, everyone. Dr. Mahendran, it's very great to have you here to listen to you. In fact, he has been one of the pioneers in Malaysia in starting ozone treatment. And in fact, I was talking with him. One of the reasons why Malaysia went very hard on vitamin C and ozone was because I think the chemotherapy drug sales came down by about 40% or 30%. So we have started this clinic about 1.5 years back. And I've been working on this for the last 18 years We have worked with a lot of the leading scientists around the world. A lot of papers published by the US government, National Institute of Health in Washington, D.C. I have been there personally in National Institute of Health, and there are three scientists who are the main scientists for researching into vitamin C. One is Dr. Mark Levin. The other one is Dr. Murli Cherikuri, who is actually from Andhra. And there's one Dr. Stephen Padayati, who's from Kerala. So these three are the leading researchers in the world on vitamin C, its effect on cancer and other diseases. In fact, there was a doctor called Klinner who practiced medicine in 1940s. And he cured polio with vitamin C after the patient was attacked and had a limb defect. Vitamin C was able to reverse even that effect. So it's been recorded, you have data, and in fact he's recorded phenomenally. It's a beautiful book written by him in the 40s, which talks about cure from so many diseases. So given this, I was thinking, okay, we should start something in our area. And I had the good fortune to meet Dr. Arul 2 years back. So because to find a doctor who is going to do this is very difficult. And to find a doctor who believes in it and his heart is in it is difficult. And I'm not a doctor, so I can't do anything. I can only talk. I can't really prescribe medicine nor run this, because we need a medical professional who's aware and who believes. So I was fortunate that, you know, we were able to meet. And then we started the clinic. And now we see very good results. We have a lot of patients whom we've been able to help. And they've given us so many feedback, so we've been able to get a very good experience. And now we have patients coming in only by word of mouth. We have not been advertising, we've not been talking to anybody. So basically we've got people coming in with referrals of other patients, and we see very good results on it. And one thing we are proud about is that you go into any oncology ward in any hospital, you will walk into a sad place. Everybody's face is going to be really sad. They're going to be, you know, you don't see a smiling face. You walk into our clinic anytime, the same patients here are smiling. So that's the greatest achievement I think we have, because we have given the patient hope. We have given them a belief that they will get well. And that's finally what medicine is about. You need the patients to get well and also believe that they will be able to lead a good life. So I'm glad that we have this opportunity, and we have Dr. Mahendran here to talk to us about medical ozone and chelation. So I'd like to welcome you, sir, and thank you very much.
Our chief guest, Dr. P. Mahendran, MBBS, MD, FRCOG, FACS, pursued his MBBS degree from University of Madras in 1965. He worked as a trainee medical officer at various hospitals in Malaysia. He completed his MRCOG in London and MD in University of Oxford. He served as a head of obstetrics and gynecology department in Malaysia for 6 years. In 2006, he started Ozone Wellness Center, introducing ozone and chelation therapy in Malaysia after completing the training in Germany. At present, he lives in USA. Now, we call upon Dr. P. Mahendran to address the gathering.
Let me start off by thanking Dr. Manikam, Dr. Arul, Dr. Sibnesh for giving me this opportunity to share with you what little I know about ozone. I am basically an obstetrician gynecologist, and when I became consultant in 1972, there were no oncologists. The oncology came in much later. So we as clinicians, we had to do the surgery and also do the chemotherapy. When we did chemotherapy, we titrated the doses in accordance to compliance. The cancer doctors were called radiotherapists, and they only did internal and external radiation. Then subsequently, the oncology field was set up maybe over 35, 36 years ago, and the oncologists took over chemotherapy from us, and they sat down and made protocols. And we as clinicians do the surgery, and we are duty bound to refer them to the oncologist for further treatment. So whenever the patient went to the oncologist, they had created protocols, and some of them could go through the complete protocol, some of them defected halfway because they can't take it, some of them totally refused and looked for alternate medication. And those who went for chemotherapy, when they couldn't take it, when they came back to us, so we had to see what was best for them. And I saw some people going off to China, some people going off to India, some people going off to Indonesia, coming back reasonably well after what they have been through. So that gave me an idea that there is something happening. But anyway, I just pushed it aside and I carry on with the obstetrics and gynecology till my wife was diagnosed with cancer colon in December 2005, and an MRI showed that he had a tumor at the before a complete. How many of you are medical doctors in this group? Any oncologists here? Any ENT surgeons here? Any pharmaceutical people here? Any ophthalmologists here? No. So when wife was down with colon, we, even though we are doctors, we always think a cancer, heart attack or a stroke will only happen to the neighbor till it happens in your own house. So it puts us in a bit of a shock. And after the surgery, I was thinking hard whether she should be subjected to chemotherapy. And all my cancer patients are virtually my friends because I've delivered 3 or 4 of their children. And those who come in bad shape after chemotherapy, some of them are so bad that they even ask me, is there something you can do to send me off? I can't take the pain anymore. But that the law doesn't allow us. So when it comes to your wife, you're going to think, what are you going to do? So I took a bold step and said, no. No chemotherapy. And of course, I had lots of relatives who are doctors. And she had one brother in the UK, one brother in Australia. And they were not very happy that I am not doing the routine which everybody was doing. So my 2 children, I called them and said, look here, I am very emotional. So I have opted not to, for the moment, subject your mother to chemotherapy. This might mean that we might lose her 2 or 3 years earlier. I rather do that than push her through 3 or 4 more years of suffering. It was a decision I took at that time, not knowing what was available. Then in 2006, this was in December 2006, April, my daughter was getting married, and all my friends, even Dr. Sivasami was there for the wedding. And after the wedding, about 17 of us all over the world were there, and we got together and we were wondering how we should proceed, but the unanimous agreement was we stop chemotherapy. Then one of our friends, in 1990, I was in US for a conference and we decided to go to Havana. And chemotherapy was basically nurtured in the communist bloc, Havana, East Germany, Russia and China. And these places were not exposed to or modern medical development or drugs were not available. Cuba was so close to America that the sanctions was imposed foolproof. And in America you don't get the Cubans presenting, but in other international conferences I was very impressed by the results of the Cubans, who in spite of the handicap had results comparable to the Western world. So there must be something they were doing. So we decided, a group of us, we went there. And one of the cosmetic surgeons, he is a US citizen from Kerala. As we are doing some sightseeing, he complained of some chest pain. So the ambulance came, took him, and he was admitted. We were told he had a mild heart attack. And the one who trained him is also a cosmetic surgeon, a very close friend of ours, Dr. Thangvel Sam, we call him Sam. So he said, I want to go and see him. So we went to the intensive care unit or coronary care unit. We saw him there and we were surprised that he wasn't given nasal oxygen or an oxygen mask, which is mandatory even for a suspected heart attack. So he wasn't happy. He said, let's go in and talk to him, better transfer him off to the US. So I went in, and that was the first time I saw ozone being used for the heart treatment, and they were just taking his blood in a blood donation bag, mixing it with ozone and retransfusing it. Of course, the blood coming out was very bluish and dark, but it became cherry red when they sent it in. And he said, look here, I don't know what they are doing. It is working. My pain has been less. My breathing is comfortable. Just leave me alone. We could see ischemic changes in the monitor. Next morning when we went to see him, we were surprised that the ECG had virtually reverted to normal. Ischemia is actually lack of oxygen caused generally by lack of blood supply. A heart attack is caused either by a thrombus or an obstruction where the blood flow is reduced. When the blood flow is reduced, the oxygen concentration reduces because the blood is what carries the oxygen. The two functions of the blood is to carry oxygen, take back carbon dioxide, carry nutrition and take back the waste products. So oxygen reduction causes ischemia anywhere, even in the skeletal muscle. We can keep running and our muscles are utilizing oxygen. The utilization of oxygen of our muscles does not compensate the amount of oxygen we can replace by breathing. So we start breathing rapidly. After a while, you can't breathe any more faster and your pain is killing you. So you stop. When you stop, your muscles stop utilizing oxygen, but you are replenishing the oxygen by breathing. So the pain generally subsides. And when the pain subsides, because oxygen is restored, you can do the run again. The other ischemic pain, perfect example, is contractions of labor pains. When the uterus contracts, there's no blood supply to the uterus. So there is no oxygen. So the pain becomes severe and severe. Once there's no oxygen and nutrition, there is no oxygen and nutrition to sustain the contraction. Because a contraction, for the muscle to contract, you need these things. So once it's exhausted, the uterus starts relaxing, the blood starts flowing, the ischemia is restored, and you get the pain. When it comes to your heart, if you reverse it, say within half an hour or so, ischemia completely disappears. But if it is sustained for a longer time, they call it infarction. Infarction is nothing but conversion of elastic tissue to fibrous tissue, and this is body's mechanism of survival. Elastic tissue functions, so it requires more nutrition and more oxygen. When the oxygen and nutrition is cut off, in order to survive, the elastic tissue becomes fibrous tissue. And this is transformation is basically the physiology of aging. When we are born, we have about 65 to 70% of elastic tissue. Babies, you know, thrown out, they jump here, they jump there. They are so pliable that they don't injure the muscles. As we grow older and older, we get more sedentary, and when we get more sedentary, our oxygen supply is reduced. So to survive, the elastic tissue becomes fibrous tissue. This is when your ligaments get fibrous, your muscles get fibrous, your blood vessels get fibrous, and that is basically the physiology of aging. So having decided that we are not going to do this, one of the in the group that said, the other day in Havana we saw a building, Ozone Cancer Therapy Center. So I said, okay, go back to the US and tell me this. So they went back and they said, there's someone. They said, why do you have to come to Havana? You go to Germany. So I decided to take my wife to Germany. And such a coincidence, I went to the university hospital, I got the notes and came down. One of my colleagues, a very high academic, he said, hey, Rasati, what are you going to do with her? So I said, believe me or not, I'm going to try out ozone. And he had a very sneaky smile and he said, I can't understand somebody with your academic credentials trying something like this, he said. He said quackery. He used the word quackery. So I didn't want to tell anybody, quietly took, I did a 6 months course. I was very, very impressed with what they were doing for cancer. Then I started working on it. I brought back a machine, put it there, and I didn't want to tell anyone. I rented a room in the hospital I was working. We started. And cancer, MRI or CT scan, it has got two spreads. One is a macroscopic spread and one is a microscopic spread. The macroscopic spread, your CT scan, PET scan, anything can show. The microscopic spread cannot be seen. But when the microscopic spread becomes macroscopic spread, you have to keep monitoring periodically with MRIs. So this was something I was doing because I was worried when this might, in spite of knowing that. That's when I realized, I mean, everybody knows that cancer cannot thrive in a high oxygen environment, and most cancer patients have got an acidic pH. So if you can convert the acidic pH to alkaline and make sure you are oxygenating the person adequately, at least you can control the progression. Anyway, you have to control the progression before you can cause regression. And this seems, I tried 6 months, 1 month, I mean 1 year, 2 years, 2.5 years, all was fine. And I was reading more and more about this. Then I found out the anti-aging aspects. So ozone not only was treating a cancer, but I decided to do the anti-aging aspect, and I thought there was a lot of potential on the anti-aging side. Then as I progressed, I got more cancer patients, and that's what I was telling Dr. Chidambaram today. I started this in 2006. Till today, I have not lost any cancer patient except my wife. My wife did not die of cancer. She died of a viral pneumonia in America. But I can tell you this, if she was not in America, she would not be dead, because there's no antiviral agent as effective as ozone. Ozone, the high concentrations of oxygen, bacteria, protozoa, virus, nothing can survive. And I don't know about chikungunya, this is disabling arthritis. And in Malaysia, people who come up on a wheelchair on the lift after ozone therapy walk down. So now I go back to this is an electron microscopic picture of a red blood cell. God has given it a configuration. No other configuration has got this much of surface. It can be a cube, it can be a rectangular slab. This particular configuration gives you maximum surface. At the surface of the red cell, it takes oxygen and gives out carbon dioxide. So this has got optimal transport mechanism as far as oxygen is concerned. This is what toxins does to the red blood cell. Toxins clusters your red cells together. And once your red cells are clustered together, they reduce the capacity of transporting oxygen. Anti-aging, I don't know whether it's my, because I'm supposed to talk only on chronic diseases. But I think even with people with chronic diseases like to remain young, right? So you got various therapies here, hormone replacement therapy, you got aesthetics, you got natural diet and exercise, which I think is about the most important. Because, you know, we got three kinds of food: carbohydrates, proteins and fat. Carbohydrate is what we consume maximum. But when you cut a chicken or a goat or whatever, you see the fat, you see the protein, but you never see the carbohydrate. What is happening to the carbohydrate? That's maximum. So carbohydrate is converted to fat and stored in the liver. So diet and exercise is the best anti-aging, except, but unfortunately, the people who utilize this particular segment are the hardcore poor, because they work out and burn all the carbohydrates they take. And this consumption of carbohydrate is something we inherited from the forefathers. But we forget our forefathers made a living with their body. Our forefathers work in the field, the farm, or wherever. So they consume the carbohydrates. Today, we are not using our body, we are using our brain. Unfortunately, brain activity does not burn your carbs. So we have evolved the way we are making our life, making a living, but we have not evolved the way we are eating. So the best thing I can tell all of you is to cut down your carbs or burn out your carbs. People didn't go to the gym those days because their working was. And there was a study conducted in Sarawak in a vegetable farm. They measured the amount of air a person breathes in and out during their working hours, and they found that they breathe 46 times more than a sedentary worker. So that, and they also burn out everything. So that causes, the causes of main problem today is excessive carbs. So you cut down your carbs, everything is fine. Of course, the next thing is ozone and chelation. Ozone is a gas that you cannot breathe because it's very pungent. But we all know ozone layer depletion is causing problems. Why is the sea blue? The sea is blue, the color of ozone is blue. So it's just a reflection of the ozone layer. Here it's, of course, first and foremost, ozone stimulates and increases the uptake of utilization of oxygen by stimulating the release of oxygen cellular level. Ozone improves circulation. I'll explain all that as we go on. Keeps the blood pliable and elastic. Slows down the plaque formation and helps to melt away easy plaque. Keeps the blood flow smoothly. All diabetic patients have vascular problems. All diabetic patients, the problem is because of the narrowing of the blood vessels. Actually, the sugar is not the culprit. Whenever you have got a spike of sugar, you have a spike of insulin. Insulin is not kind to the mucosa or endothelium of the artery. So when the insulin damages the endothelium of the artery, the physiological response to any tissue damage is the formation of a clot. And that clot is triggered by the platelet factors. So once there's a clot, this is the beginning of the obstruction that's going to come to the arteries. The heart beats 70 times per minute and 100,000 times a day. An average lifespan, it beats 2.5 billion times. And this might be news to you. Your heart moves 7,200 liters of blood every day and stops only when we die. I've just drawn out a comparison between a car and a human being. The car, the central unit, is the engine. In conventional medicine today, they can't decide whether it's the brain or the heart that is the center. Agreed. Even the respiratory center and the cardiovascular center are situated in the brain. So they say brain is. But thinking outside conventional medicine, I would vote for heart, because I can show you patients who are brain dead and alive. Is there anybody who is heart dead who can be alive? So I feel heart has got more importance than the brain. Your vehicles, you service 5,000 kilometers once or 10,000 kilometers once. Human beings, we never service ours. And as long as we made a living by the body, it did not require service. Now we don't make a living by a body, that's why we hear for detox and all kinds of things. So we are created to service our system by using our muscle, which we don't do. And hence, we have got all these problems. So, if we decide to work out or cut down our carbs, obviously the body takes care of itself. Lifespan of a car now probably gone to 20 years. And humans, I know in Malaysia, we have moved up to 77 and 79. If there's a problem with a car, you replace. There's a problem with a human, I put there, G-H-Y, God help you. Oxygen has got two atoms of ozone, oxygen, and ozone has got three atoms of oxygen. So, ozone actually has 50% more oxygen than oxygen itself. So, it's actually a super oxygen. What does it achieve? Ozone, I think I'll come back to that slide later. Here, I'm just telling you that two molecules of ozone becomes three molecules of oxygen. When we breathe, the atmospheric air has got 20%. Now the issue has come down to 17% oxygen. When we breathe out, our air passage has got no oxygen. It is replaced by carbon dioxide. When we take the next breath in, the air in your air passage goes in before the air goes in. So the 20% becomes 15% or 16%. When we put ozone inside, we are virtually putting 150% of oxygen into your system. So, however much you breathe, however much you exercise, you cannot compensate the amount of oxygen going into your system by ozone. And everything in the body has got optimal. Beyond that, you cannot. So, if you give 150% oxygen, you are going to reach an optimal stage, that will be 98%, 99%, 100%. You cannot have any more oxygen. There is one atom from the ozone which is free. Nothing can sustain as an atom. It has to combine instantly with something to form a molecule. So this discarded oxygen atom from the ozone cannot form oxygen. So it has to find something. What else we have abundance in our body is nitrogen, waste product. NO becomes nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is the most potent vasodilator. It opens up all your blood vessels. The GTN tablets heart patients give, the active reagent is actually nitric oxide. So now you have got enriched oxygen and dilatation of all the peripheral capillaries. You see, oxygen transmission to the cells is not done by the bigger arteries or veins. They are all done by microcapillaries. Would you believe me if I tell you an adult human has got 30,000 miles of microcapillaries? Wherever you prick, you bleed. So, these capillaries open up, oxygen concentration is 50% more. So, can you imagine the tissue perfusion, the amount of oxygen available at the mitochondrial level? And this is what is required to boost your immune system. Your immune system is your defense. Any country which has got a good air force, navy and army, nobody can invade. So, immune system is basically boosted by the mitochondrial activity and amount of oxygen that is necessary. When you talk of immune system, there are two things that basically holds your repair mechanism. One is the stem cells. The more you read about stem cells, the more complicated it is. You see, stem cell in very simple form is actually a multi-purpose spare part. Sperm embryo fuses, and you get the 8-cell blastocyst. These 8 cells can differentiate in nose, ear, pancreas, liver. That's how a fetus is formed. So these stem cells are present, and that's why we call it embryonic stem cells. They are present in our body as our basic repair mechanism. And unfortunately, as you grow older and more sedentary and don't give enough oxygen, it's our fault that the stem cell population comes down. And how stem cells work? See, supposing you scratch your nose, it bleeds. This stem cell sticks there, and becomes a nasal mucosal cell. Say, supposing you scratch your skin, it bleeds. It sticks there and becomes a skin cell. Suppose you got a gastric something ulcer, it sticks there and it. So these stem cells population is known to increase after stimulating the ozone system. And along with that, there are also some anti-tumor enzymes. One of them is interferon. The interferon increase is also about 15 to 20%. So basically, when you oxidate, your immune system is boosted to fight against any disease. Now you have reached a stage when you have got optimal nitric oxide. You cannot have any more nitric oxide. So again, there is one, you know, an orphan, as you call, the oxygen atom, which is looking to attach to something. What else do we have in abundance in our body is water. Water is H2O. So when you put in one more atom to that, it becomes H2O2. H2O2 is hydrogen peroxide. We know that hydrogen peroxide has been used for cleaning wounds for a long, long time. Hydrogen peroxide has got a very peculiar property. When you put in a normal tissue, it remains hydrogen peroxide. But whenever you put it on a wound or granulation or tumor, you see bubbles coming out. It breaks down to oxygen and water. So oxygen is actually delivered at the site wherever you have a problem. And this is how it acts on cancer. Cancer is a necrotic tumor. So when you treat them with ozone, you are hitting the tumor with oxygen. And tumor, cancer cannot thrive in a high oxygen environment. And this is one of the basis of how ozone is employed in the treatment of cancer. I've already said that. This is extracorporeal blood. This is the same thing I said, and it's more for doctors. ATP, adenosine triphosphate. We go to the basic physiology of utilization of oxygen. Metabolic process that uses ATP as energy source to convert back into precursors of ATP, and therefore the continuous recycle is, it's all technical. But one thing I can tell you, this is the enzyme that nourishes the very core of our cells. What does ozone do? It retards the aging process. How does it retard the aging process? It retards the conversion of elastic tissue to fibrous tissue. Because elastic tissue converts to fibrous tissue because you don't give enough oxygen. So you give more oxygen, of course it kills bacteria and viruses, it oxidizes. Whenever you go for any form of unconventional medicine, the first thing they tell you is do the detox. That is, remove all your toxins. Prevents the propagation of cancer cells, potentiates the effect of chemotherapy and minimizes. How does it potentiate the effect of chemotherapy? By simply causing vasodilation of where the tumor is, so that more of the chemotherapy hits a tumor than otherwise. Improves brain function, of course it improves brain function, cardiac function. Stimulation of the immune system, I already dealt with. And the other thing we have to see is, when your coronaries are blocked, you get symptoms. So you do a bypass, you get that solved out. But I think it is very rational and logical to assume, if your coronary arteries are blocked, your arteries all over are blocked. Your liver, your kidney, your brain, everywhere. But those things don't give symptoms. And the downside of biochemistry is, your kidney function will be normal until 60 or 65% of it is gone. So by the time you see your blood urea or creatinine is coming up, that means more than half your kidney is gone, and so the liver. The body is such an efficient thing that it can still with 20 or 30% perform the function of that. How do we become oxygen deficient? Unhealthy eating habits, insecticides, pesticides, all that, increased sedentary life, again you are breathing. You see, your basic Veda says the essence of life is prana. What is prana? Breathing. It's oxygen. So So when you are oxygen deficient, all this happens. Pesticides in the vegetables and fruit we eat, that is something which is out of control. Heavy metal and other toxins, hormones that we have, impurities. You see, 50-60 years ago, cancer was not rampant. Cancer is rampant today. And I tell you, it was created by us. The basic problem, I don't know about here, in Malaysia, 1 in 5 deaths are caused by cancer. And that is the water we drink. 1,007 cities have moved from chlorine to ozone for purification of water. Chlorine is something, when you boil to 100 degrees, which you have to do if you cook your food or make your coffee, chlorine is converted to a compound called trichloroethylene, which is a known carcinogen. So if you have any filters at home, make sure you take the chlorine out of the water. And of course, the best filter you can have now is a reverse osmosis, because that's the only filter that filters out suspended and dissolved impurities. Unfortunately, reverse osmosis water is slightly acidic. All you have to do is put a slice of lemon, it becomes alkaline. And pollution, the air we breathe is polluted. Toxins produced by medications. This was a very hidden thing which came out very recently. In 2008, 17% of Americans were dying of toxicity of the medicines they were taking. And allopathic medication is treated by the liver as a foreign body. So actually, to eliminate, only less than 50% of what you take is actually absorbed. To eliminate the 50%, the liver is taxed. So at the end of the day, they tell you multi-organ failure. What is multi-organ failure? Your liver and the kidneys are gone. And these are the two organs that brings us. And of course, stress, that we can't help, that's part of our living today. How do we get rid of toxins? Breathing, of course, carbon dioxide. Defecation, all fat-soluble toxins oxidized in the liver comes out through that. And urination, of course, water-soluble. Salivation also. You see, when you see people, you see football or any game, you see these athletes spitting. They are not spitting because they want to spit. They breathe through their mouth and there's so much of dust that they spit it out. Spitting is actually healthy. Those days, the people working in the farms and fields were chewing tobacco or betel nut and spitting. That was healthy and preventing. Now, spitting is bad manners. So, we swallow all the toxins. Sweating, yes. These are the things lack of oxygen causes. Depression, fatigue, irritability, memory loss, respiratory problems, circulatory problems, suppressed immune system, muscle or joint pain. If you just take a visit to the village where people are, you know, do farming or gardening or plantation work, you never see them depressed. They get enough to eat, they are happy, no depression, no blood pressure, no diabetes. These are the various methods that you can administer ozone. Intravenous oxygen gas direct. You will be surprised, in Havana, there are no amputations for gangrene. They are so courageous, they inject ozone gas directly into the femoral artery. And when we talk of $1 million or ₹1 million worth of hyperbaric oxygen chambers, they say you put the foot in the oxygen chamber, how much oxygen can dead tissue absorb? So when you put oxygen inside, you get your nitric oxide, you get your hydrogen peroxide, and you also get increased oxygen. And dramatic reversal of gangrene. Intra-articular, of course, is used for joint pains. Intra-vaginal is very popular. Intra-rectal is becoming very, very, very popular in Havana now. Lots of papers have come. And intrarectal is very effective, I am told, and it is very easy and cheap to administer. But when I went to Germany, I said, I want to have the most effective method of euthanization, and they suggested EBO or extracorporeal blood oxygenation euthanization. So I opted to choose this because I didn't learn this because I want to learn integrated medicine. I learned this because I wanted to save my wife. So the motivation is much, much more. And I made myself familiar with EBO and I learned everything about EBO. It was easier to learn a complicated system first because you can always come down. You start from the bottom, then of course you got to go step by step. And I started EBO. This is a machine that I use, Longevity, made in Canada. You see, EBO is just taking blood out from one vein, putting into a dialyzer, ozonating the blood and getting it out. So as you see here, the blood goes in from here, goes up, out, and oxygen is converted to ozone by this machine, Longevity, it comes there. We give enough oxygen there to saturate this whole dialyzer or chamber of blood. And this detox takes here, as I told you, there are two types of toxins, water soluble and fat soluble. When you put oil and water together, the fat goes up. So the fat goes up and there's a diaphragm there, 0.0002 microns, which does not allow the fat to go beyond that. And water soluble toxins comes down and drains inside the cylinder. So the detox here, this is actually a turbocharged liver and kidney functioning outside your body. So the water soluble toxins drains down. And the fat soluble toxins is all blocked at that level. Sometimes we get water soluble toxins, say up 500 ml, and there are also times we get water soluble toxins up to 2000 ml. Our blood volume is 5 to 6 liters. If you get 2000 ml coming out, we would die. So what's actually happening? You see, we have got extravascular, intravascular fluids. So the toxins, when you remove from the blood, the toxins from the body comes into the blood. And when we start first, you are removing 30, 40, 50 years of accumulated toxins. So my regime usually is, we do this till the toxins comes below 500, then we know we have somehow cleared your toxins. And then, of course, we draw up a regime. And of course, the best way is to, see, this is the patient having the EBO treatment. This is the color of the blood. This is autohemotherapy. See, this is what ozone actually does. Vasodilatation, I told you, is nitric oxide. Reduced hypoxia means it increases your oxygenation. This is a very interesting study which was done by a Cuban colleague of mine who did this in Italy. His wife was Italian. He took a micron electroscopic picture of the dorsum of the hand before treatment with ozone, a normal person. And after 3 months, he repeated it and he found new microcapillaries. And he even called it neoangiogenesis. Neo in medicine means formation of new microcapillaries. So he was so ecstatic, so happy when he called me. I just listened to him. I didn't want to break out his enthusiasm. I called him a few days later and I said, look here, I'm an obstetrician. Everything is formed when you are born. It only becomes bigger. So I don't think it is fair for you to use the term neoangiogenesis. So he said, mind and what do I do? I said, you know what's happening in the beginning, you know what's happening in the end. Just frame and find out what's happening in between. So he said, how do I do that? He said, simply do a video. So he decided to do the video. And let's assume that this is a microcapillary. We all know toxins clusters the blood cells. When it clusters enough to obstruct the inlet of the microcapillary, of course, blood does not flow. And blood flowing through a microcapillary is not like blood flowing through a tap. We have got two pressures there, systolic and diastolic. So it goes in curves. So this actually empties the whole microcapillary. When it empties the whole microcapillary, the whole thing collapses. It's like a balloon without air. So eventually, it is actually a tube but does not function because blood does not flow. When you ozonate this person, this toxins which holding the blood dissimulates and it unlocks the block. So when this is unlocked, blood starts flowing through. So it's actually a remodeling or reflow which has not been opened for a long time. So we found out that ozone opens up blood capillaries. So then of course he revised the whole thing. And this gives me an idea, because I was using reading glasses for 21 years and now I am reading without glasses. I'm 80 this year. And I asked ophthalmologists, can you explain? None of them could explain. This gave me the explanation for this. You see, you got your lens, you got your retina. We all know the retina is a very vascular organ. By looking at the microcapillary for retina, you can diagnose hypertension, diabetes and everything else. If the retina moves back, you get hypermetropia or reading glasses. If the retina is swollen or diseased, you get your myopia, whatever astigmatism or whatever other diseases you have. How we wear reading glasses at 40 or 45, but your skull doesn't grow after you're 25. So how does the retina move back? The retina does not move back, but it becomes thinner because all the vascularization becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. And I discovered this by accident. I had a cancer patient with me with a histopath report. I broke my reading glasses. So I told my nurse to bring the reading glasses. And when she came, I've already read it without my glasses. Only then I realized that I don't need glasses anymore. This, you can see the vessel here. As I told you, how does the block start? Especially diabetes, let's take that. First, if there's a bleed here, a clot forms, then it starts building. Then the next time you take excessive carbs, it bleeds here. So eventually you get up to this. So when you start doing ozone, you start clearing the little amount of toxins, and eventually this is what you hope to achieve. That's of course an antioxidant. I only did cancer therapy till this date, 4th of February 2009. This patient came to see me. He was a Hindu, Indian, Tamil, 47 years old, who had a heart attack and was admitted to the Heart Institute, and he was told he needs an emergency bypass. For some reason, the mother in astrology or whatever it is, they decided that they are not going to, and they came to see me because the astrologer who saw that was also my patient. And of course, I treated the astrologer for viral myocarditis, which he was a dramatic improvement. So he came to see me and he said, I am not going to do a bypass, have you got anything to offer? So I said, I have not treated any heart patients, but I know it works in a heart attack, and if you are happy, I will give it a try. But don't blame me if something happens in between. He agreed. The mother said, no way am I going to subject him for the next 1 or 2 years. So I looked at his blood and I said, okay, and we did an EBU. After it had broken up to this, and I think he had about 1,000 liters of water soluble toxins. So I decided to combine. I know Dr. Crinton, you must have known his book, How to Bypass Surgery. I knew it helped in calcified blocks. So I did a few ozone treatments, then I followed up with chelation, and after 5 chelations we did the EBO again. This was on the 25th of March 2009, before and this was after. Then he had 30 chelations with EBO in between, and in August, after 30 chelations and 3 or 4 EBOs in between, this was on the 5th of August, before and this was after. So I told him, you go back to IGN and you insist on an angiogram before, even if they want to do a bypass. He said, no, they won't do that, they already told me. He said, it doesn't matter. So he went to a private center and he did an angiogram. And 55% of his blocks are cleared with a combination of chelation and ozone. You see, your ozone level is high for about 6 hours after treatment. Eventually, it really reaches baseline only after 48 hours. This is very theoretical and I didn't know about it. This is another interesting case of a 39-year-old gentleman who had severe body pains. He had been through all the specialties and eventually they decided to send him to a psychiatrist. He was a very high executive in a pest control company. So he came and told me, is there anything? I said, I don't know whether I can help you, but having been in a pest control system, there might be some toxins. So why don't you try? So he tried this. This was the 30th of November, before, and this was after. It looked beautiful. So I said, I am amazed how it got so clear. So he went back home, and exactly 48 hours later, he calls me and says, he has got excruciating pain. And I said, why don't you come over? He lives in a town, Sramban, which is about an hour's drive from where I live, Malacca. He said, it's so painful, I can't even drive. Can you find somebody? Then he got his brother and he came. And unfortunately, I was fully slaughtered for that day. The next day was a Sunday. So I said, I don't know what to do. Then I said, okay, he sat down. He's not diabetic. I gave 6 liters of normal saline. Pass urine. He said 50% of his pain had come down. I said, okay, you come back. Then he comes back 48 hours later. And I was shocked to see this. You see, when you have got so much, when you look at the whole body, the body is the house. The blood is actually the dustbin. It throws all the waste into the blood. And the removal areas are your kidney and the liver. If the dustbin is full, how can they throw? So the moment you remove stuff from the dustbin, the back pressure just pushes the toxins inside. So by the first look, cursory look, don't assume that everything is fine. This is a patient, 4th December, before, after. See, once you remove the soft tissue inside the blood vessel, that's when you hit the hard stuff. The hard stuff is either calcified clots or solidified fat. So after 3 or 4 ozones, if you think like this comes, we had to call something. So I decided to call them crystals, though you can't make jewelry out of it. So these crystals appear in small, this is just in one drop of blood. Can you see this? If this is in one drop of blood, how much is there going around in your whole system? So this is when chelation comes in. You see, I spoke to an assistant, Dr. Creighton. He says, how is it you remove calcium by using EDTA? EDTA is known to remove heavy metal. You see, when we think of heavy metal, we think of a copper pipe iron nail. But the heavy metal we have in the body, we have iron, we have magnesium, we have cadmium, is all in liquid form. Only when this liquid form becomes solid, then we have got problems. So this calcium is like a brick. It's a heavy metal. You know, when you lay brick, you put cement all around it. So it's a heavy metal that is holding the calcium together. So when you dislodge the cement, the brick falls apart. And this is precisely how chelation which is used to remove heavy metal removes calcified blood vessels. This is a story, it's a very, very sad story, but I must share it with you. I delivered the baby of a gentleman, a Chinese gentleman, his first baby, boy, and he seemed very sad. I asked him, what's your problem? He said, it's my dad, he's admitted with a heart attack. So he said, can you do anything about it? I said, look here, I can't do much now. You get him out. Once, I'm sure they'll do an angiogram and you come back to me. You see, look at this blood. There's hardly any oxygen carrying capacity. The surface of the cell that carries, there's hardly any surface here. For conventional medicine, we want to do surgery, we say, okay, hemoglobin. 13, 14, we are very, very happy. To me, I'll be happy with somebody with 7 or 8 with individual cells than someone like this. Because having 13 or 14 hemoglobin with this kind of a picture, there's hardly any available, I mean, transport mechanism derailed. So he insisted, I went to the ICU, took a drop of blood, and I was shocked to see this. And next morning when I saw him, he said it passed away. This is another case where you see excessive toxin comes out. This is a patient where there are 3 courses of chemotherapy. When I looked at it, I was very happy. I said, hey, this is fantastic. So again, she had an EBU, and I was shocked to see it is even worse after that. So again, when you remove it, you are decompressing the blood, and whatever is in the tissues comes out. So if this lady is going to be carrying on with chemo, we know how much of it is going to damage the system. This is, just look at the second paragraph. It is the pharmaceutical companies and other members of the medical industry that make the decision. The powers that control mainstream medicine have only one interest only, the bottom line. And the bottom line is always best served with therapies that treat symptoms and not therapies that cure. Because by treating symptoms, you can treat them forever, sell your medicines forever. Once you cure them, they are not going to come back to you. So remember that. Go to somebody who can cure you and not suppress your symptoms. You get a headache, fine, you take an aspirin. But if you ask causes of headache, they say there's 56 from standing in the sun to the brain tumor. So check out. Don't keep on taking the tablets which they ask you to take. Go and check out what is causing it and get it out of the way. Of course, the other thing about this is ozone appears in nature. It cannot be patented. And whenever I put my results, they say this is anecdotal. You don't have comparison. I mean, doctors here know what a double-blind trial is, but to those who are not doctors, let me explain this. Because double-blind trial, say you take 2 people who are bald. We take 50 of those and 100. 50 get the medicine for baldness, 50 get a placebo, that is a vitamin or something. And the doctor doesn't know, the patient doesn't know, it's coded. Of course, the pharmaceuticals finance this. After 6 months, they decode. If 50% of those who are on medication have grown hair, and less than 50% of those on placebo, this is approved. Which patient who has got cancer or which patient who has got a heart attack is going to surrender for a placebo? And number 2, who finances these things? The only people who finance medical drugs are the pharmaceuticals. I did, in my Oxford doctorate, I did a research on the drug called prostaglandins by Upjohn. They paid me for the time, They gave me the drugs to do. At the end of 1 year, I gave them the results. Today, if a pharmaceutical company employs you to do research, they give you 60% in shares and 40% in cash. When they give you 60% shares in the pharmaceutical company, how can you put an honest tag on what you have done? Safety of ozone, 0.0007%, not even the use of aspirin can approach this margin. What can oxygen do if it is regulated? It can do nothing. It can only make you more alive, more active. And then 384,775 patients treated with different ozone modalities for various variety of medical conditions were studied. A total of 5,579,238 treatments using primary major autohemotherapy. And what was the accident level? 0.0007%. So that is how it is stated. Oxygen is not patentable, I have told you. This is a filter which we use for ozone. Can you see the blood coming in is dark, going out is bright, and what is stuck on the walls is actually the fat. Can you see the fat coming out? This is the blood, that venous blood, and all this is what you see is the fat. So there's so much of fat in your system when you eat the carbs and don't burn it. Remember that. So when you eat carbs, you burn it. If you don't burn it, cut down your carbs. And the fat in your body is no issue at all. It's only the fat in your blood vessels that cause you the problem. There's the same patient, actually a cousin of mine, a civil engineer from Brisbane, who had heart problems. Chelation, they say, non-surgical treatment of heart disease and atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis means just hardening of your blood vessels. This is all Dr. Creighton's, his textbook of EDTA, bypassing. I'll just go briefly. No need for hospital, 3-hour procedure. Now I think we have brought it down to about 1.5 hours. This is Dr. Clinton's pictures, I think from the 1960s, they are all black and white. I want to preserve. What does it treat? Heart disease, brain, leg. Let's briefly go through this. Mechanism binds metals, and I've already explained that to you. These are the, this is all academic, cobalt, all published studies. See, this is from Clark. 20 patients, 6 with unstable angina, complete relief of angina in 17 of 20 patients. 16 asymptomatic after 21 months. ECG normalized in 33%. This is also a small study. I'll go to the bigger ones. This is 1,130 patients, 91% complete recovery, 8% good, 7 to 9 patients with dry gangrene had satisfactory recovery. Anyway, let's go. Measuring blood flow. You see, the coronary artery is so small that you can't conduct any studies. Fortunately for us, the carotids, iliofemorals, you can study. And this is what we do too. This is a computer graphic representation of the blood flow of your carotid artery. As I said, it goes in waves. Systolic, it goes up, diastolic bounces. This is again a computer graphic of what happens when you've got abnormal blood flow. If you have an abnormal construction, what happens? The pressure does not come out. They say a 2-inch pipe becomes 1-inch, obviously the pressure has to be up because the peripheral resistance is the same. And of course, if it's extreme, the pressure does not come up, and that is what causes a stroke, either by coagulation or by rupture. This is a recording of the carotids which we did, the right and left, normal person. This you see a 51-year-old man. For some reason, the accident happens in the left side of the brain, and 8 out of 10 people have got right-sided paralysis. I really don't know why. See, the mainstream here, this is before treatment, this is after treatment. So obviously, the blood supply has improved, the pipes have become wider, and the pressure has dropped. This is a 72-year-old man, reasonably good. This is a 62-year. Can you see the spike there and how it has come down after? That means the blood vessels have definitely dilated. This is 57-year-old. This is a 66-year-old. This is amazing. A 92-year-old man who had right-sided paralysis. See the treatment. He came in a wheelchair, then he came with a walker, then he came with a walking stick, and you won't believe after 8 months he walked into my clinic. All published studies. I think that this is again gangrene treated with chelation. This is something I want to show you. This is carotid artery study. Before chelation therapy, 11th of May 2000. After chelation therapy, November 2000. Can you see the increase in blood flow? This is before chelation, April 13th. This is iliofemoral, after chelation, 2000. So if this is not proof enough, what chelation does to your blood vessels, I know what else will. With that, I think I conclude. Thank you very much for having the patience to listen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Ramalingam and I work in PSG Medical College. Currently, I am the dean of the college and the teaching hospital. Well, it all started about 2 years ago. I met with Dr. Manikam in one of the parties organized by our managing trustee, Sri L. Gopalakrishnan. And we all sat together around a table, and he asked me, what do I think of vitamin C in malignancy? That was his question. I said, sir, this is, I was just then out of surgery, 2017, surgery done for my renal cell carcinoma. It was localized. So they said, let's throw it out and you are done and dusted. Fortunately, I was not dusted. So the fresh out of the surgery, we had a conversation with him. And I said, sir, things like vitamin C, all this are, so many people are talking. And I'm not sure whether there is enough evidence. He then said there are quite a few evidences for that, and he cited a few and said I think you should have a look at them. And I just did nothing more to it after acknowledging his words. Recently I was detected with some secondaries in my lungs. So I was really up against the wall. Then I said, okay, let me consult the oncologist and see what can be done. They prescribed the most recent guideline-based therapy, the first-line therapy, TKI, tyrosine kinase inhibitor, with checkpoint inhibitor. That's one of the newer varieties, pembrolizumab. And then my good friend Dr. Karthikeyan, who is also here, he reminded me, I had forgotten about vitamin C. So he said, why don't you talk to him? Why don't you talk to Dr. Monicum? Then I said, okay, I will try. And then gave his office a call. And the secretary said, he is in a meeting now. He will call you back. Honestly, I didn't expect he would call me back. Because, well, he is chairman and managing director of so many companies. I'm after all an employee in an organization. So didn't expect him to call me back. But suddenly I had the call. So I said, sir, thank you very much. And then I told him, I now have a problem. I would like to start with vitamin C trip. I don't know how long I have. Can I? Thank you. I won't take very long, I also assure you. So I said I would like to visit your center. No, I didn't know this center had come up. Though I had actually come for the inaugural. I was here for the inaugural, for the talk, in the same auditorium, I think. There was a talk by a Western gentleman, and listened to it, part of inauguration, and it had fled my memory, because I had no need for this at that time. So I said, I will come there and talk to the medical person, and he reassured me that I need not worry too much. So I came here, met with Dr. Arul, Karthikeyan was with me, my wife was with me, and another friend of mine, Jagannathan, who's one of the family members, is suffering from malignancy too. He said that we could really help you, and at that time I thought I would also take the chemo, I mean the TKI, tyrosine kinase inhibitor, and the first line drug. And then I asked him, sir, this is my plan. I will take that as well as the vitamin C. And I am basically trained in science. Therefore, I had by then, within a week's time, I dug up all the literature related to vitamin C, its activity, how it works, all that. I was convinced. Immeasurably convinced of its biochemical basis and its potency. Then my wife is equally curious and is into science. Therefore, she did search for literature. There was one exquisite paper. For those of you who are interested in science and who can look up literature, this publication is from a journal called Cell Cancer. If you look at medical echelon of medical literature, Nature, not bio, just medical literature, biomedical literature, Nature, Science, Cell. These three are the top rung journals. Next comes, of course, NEJM, all that. So this was in Cell. And then I said, look at the authors. The gentleman is a hemonc person, I forget his name, an Indian hemonc person from Mayo. And it was an excellent review until published in 2018. I have sent it to sir, I have sent it to Dr. Arul, my former student, budding oncologist, alternate oncologist, Sibinesh, and a few others who are interested in my welfare. So I sent them all this publication because this is proof enough. It's a review from start of the thinking that vitamin C can help in all chronic diseases, including cancer, until 2017, he has written up. There is what's generally called proof of concept. They have done preclinical work. They have done case studies. They have also done isolated clinical trials, phase one they have done, and small numbers. Their problem is, as Professor Mahendran said, they are not able to proceed with RCTs, randomized controlled clinical trials. Fortunately or unfortunately, medical science is stuck with this RCT as the design. They may dispose of the randomized, but it has to be a controlled clinical trial. Now, you cannot, and by the quote-unquote ethical guidelines of medical science, you are not supposed to withhold standard of care, what's called standard of care. So they are stuck, and there is no one to sponsor these studies. If I need to talk to you about all that, it will get way too late. FDA is not a foolproof organization. I have been in the United States. I worked in Stanford University. The last 6 months, I worked for a lab, Baxter Lab. I have no, because right then itself, my boss fought with the lab. FDA works on a very wheeled manner, in the sense its finance does not come from government of United States. Possibly a little bit, 20% comes from the government of United States. The entire FDA, rest of FDA, is run by the projects funded by pharmaceutical companies. So what's happening there? And there are enough publications. There are enough publications on the manner of running. The Indian CDSCO is much better. Only thing is, we have not known to govern ourselves. We are not known to govern ourselves. But Indian CDSCO as an organization is rightly funded by the government. Likewise, European, EMEA they call it, European Medical some agency. And likewise, Japanese. Japanese is the toughest in the world. Why am I saying this? We are all hung up on RCTs. We are all hung up on FDA. And FDA approves a drug such as what I have taken. I had hell. I started on week 1. Week 2, my blood pressure touched 210 over 110. And I very nearly stopped passing urine. And I was confused. How do you walk around? I don't know. It was very difficult because I had some religious backing, suicidal thoughts, all those kinds of things. But because I had very firm faith in God, I held back. Hell, I said, see, if I am going to die, I am ready to die. Fortunately, from the beginning of human race until now, mortality is 100% for everybody. It may be now for a few, it may be a few years later for others. So I said, okay, but I want to not lose my sense of living until I am dead. There's no way I'm going to touch this. So I, within a week, switched 100% to vitamin C. I'm on the treatment now with this center. For me, I was just thinking, what are the adverse effects? One is I have to drive from Coimbatore. See, it takes away almost, the whole day. I travel, come here some 2-3 hours, and then by the time I get back, I find everybody gone in the campus. So that's one adverse effect. Second is pricking. I have a very fluffy, chubby thing. They are not able to find it easily. These are the adverse effects. But I am full of my former spirit. I'm telling you, vitamin C has enough scientific basis, has enough scientific basis, as much basis as checkpoint inhibitors. I was reading about checkpoint inhibitor and the way Allison, he got the Nobel last year. He is working in MD Anderson. He joined as a medical student. Within 2 years, he finds that disease rubbish. For some reason, he didn't like medicine. He said he will go to biochemistry, went to biochemistry, pursued, and path-breaking research. The way they found checkpoint inhibitor, one of the recent class of drugs in malignancy, is fabulous, fascinating. It also has superb science, T lymphocyte with two kinds of receptors. They are the ones which are holding back the T lymphocyte, and this inhibitor, pembrolizumab, ipilimab, all that, they take away those checkpoints. So T lymphocyte launches its attack on cancer cells. Unfortunately, for a few percentage of fellows like me, it launches the attack on everything. And I looked at the heart data published in New England Journal of Medicine. It says 75% of people, 75% of people develop grade 3 or more adverse effects. Grade 3, they have graded from 0 to grade 5, right? 5 is the most severe. So 3 and above, 75% of the people, 75% of the people, as against 70% in the second line. It's still considered line 1, first line drug, because it's able to fix in a slightly larger number of people. I mean, the survival Kaplan-Meier curve, they call it, that's fairly impressive if you compare it with the second line. But the adverse effects are killing. I am very hopeful that vitamin C would help me, and I'm also sure that for the time, see, my life is not in anyone's hand, including mine. It God decides. As I said, I cannot say no to death when it visits me, anytime. I am willing to take it when it comes, but I want to live the normal life for as long as I can. And I am happy that I have switched to vitamin C, and it's not that bleak. Results are very impressive. Results are very impressive for my condition, which they call MRCC, metastatic RCC. There is one publication in which a 9 centimeter mass completely resolves, given up by the conventional medicine, asked to go home on hospice in the United States. That fellow goes to New Mexico for integrative medicine and starts 9 years. He's still living. And in the YouTube, you just check. One police officer in New Zealand, Anton somebody, it comes there. This guy sent home, I think leukemia, sent home on hospice. This guy, he goes to, he's a policeman, he goes to the force, asks them, I'm going to die, bury me with my uniform. He goes there seeking permission. Those fellows say, don't give up, try high dose vitamin C, you should be all right. He runs marathons now. See, we are still not ready to believe that, if it had no basis, I will not talk like this. It has a solid, what they call pharmacological basis. Incidentally, I'm a pharmacologist. I'm a pharmacologist, and therefore I know that the basis, scientific basis, is important. And it is there, they have shown in various studies. Only thing is, large scale trial has not taken place. I doubt whether it will, because no pharmaceutical company will be interested to take it up and push it through. Unless we force the government to have some other policy, it's unlikely to come to an approved drug level. And I listened with great interest Professor Mahendran's talk. Amazing to see the effects of ozone. With the permission of the House, I would just like to field one question to you, sir. The question is, you said it's antimicrobial, ozone. Now, rectal ozone, I'm prescribed that. Would it not kill the regular gut microbiome?
Hello.
Okay.
This is local killing. But the killing is only local on the surface. But the rectal ozone is going into the
bloodstream.
And rectal ozone is chosen because the corrugation gives a bigger surface. And rectal ozone is more sturdy than everything else because feces is very acidic. So rectal mucosa is much thicker than the mucosa as it comes out of the stomach. The mucosa becomes thicker because the feces become acidic. So rectal mucosa is designed to withstand acidity. So it's the strongest of the intestinal mucosa. So locally it kills the microbes, but again making the feces clean.
Okay, no. The gut microbiome, which is normal flora,
right.
It's supposed to.
So they always.
Okay. Okay. Right. And they regrow.
Right.
Understand, sir. So thank you. Thanks for the opportunity to talk to you. I am grateful and hopeful too. Thank you.
Good evening to all. I will talk in Tamil. Sure. History solapona on. I am suffering for 5 years. That is therapy. Color therapy. 50 sittings. No effect. Then I went to flower essence therapy. That is no effect. அதாவது என்ன ரூமேட்டிக் ஆர்த்ரைட்டிஸ்னு கண்டுபிடிக்கிறக்கே 6 months ஆச்சுங்க. ஐ சஃபர்ட். ஆஃப்டர் தட் தென் ஐ வென்ட் டு லாட் ஆஃப் ஹாஸ்பிட்டல். பேரை சொல்ல வேண்டாம். கோயம்புத்தூரில் எல்லா ஆஸ்பத்திரியும் போனேன். எல்லாரும் கையை விட்டாங்க. யூ கோ ஃபார் ஆல்டர்னேட் மெடிசின். தென் மை டாக்டர் சே யூ கோ ஃபார் வர்மா. என்னடா பண்ணுறதுன்னு யோசிச்சுட்டே இருந்தேன். தென் ஒன் டே மை கசின், இந்த மாதிரி ஓசோன்னு இருக்குன்னு சொல்கிறாங்க, போய் பார்த்துட்டு வருவோம். நான் அப்போ நான் வரும்பொழுது ஸ்டிக்கு யூஸ் பண்ணிட்டு தான் வந்தேன் ஃபஸ்ட்டு. இப்போவும் யூஸ் பண்ணுறேன். அதாவது 24/4/19 April 24th ஐ என்டர்ட் வெல்னஸ் கேர் கிளினிக். பின்ன அப்போ வந்து ஏன்னா அருளில் எனக்கு தெரியும். ஏன்னா என் ஃபாதர் வந்து கந்தசாமி ப்ரொஃபஸர் ஹிஸ்ட்ரி. நான் படிக்கும்போது அவர் என்ஜிஎம் காலேஜில் ப்ரொஃபஸர். நல்லா சொன்னேன், ஆல்ரைட் ஐ வில் டேக் கேர் ஆஃப் யூன்னார். அவர் பேசினதில் எனக்கு ஒரு ஒரு நம்பிக்கை இருந்தது. கூட வந்தவர் முதல்ல பிளட் டெஸ்ட் எடுக்க சொன்னாங்க. அவருக்கு எனக்கு பிளட் டெஸ்ட்டுக்கு ஒரு 5000 ரூபா, அவருக்கு பிளட் டெஸ்ட்டுக்கே 15000 ரூபா. நாங்கள் உடனே சொல்லாமல் ஓடிட்டார். ஏன்னா நான் 5000க்கு ஏன் செஞ்சேன்னா, கடந்த 2 வருஷமாக ஐ ஸ்பெண்ட் மோர் தென் 4 to 5 lakhs. எனக்கு இந்த 5000 ரூபான்னு பெருசாக தெரியல. சரி பார்ப்போம். அதான் கடைசியில் எல்லாமே விட்டாங்களே ஆல்டர்னேட் மெடிசன்னு. சரி, இந்த அன்னைக்கு வெயிட்டு வந்து 104. அடிக்கடி சேர்மனை பார்ப்பேன். அதாவது 6 மாதம் ஸ்கூலுக்கு போகிற மாதிரி 9:30 ஐ ஆம் இன் த ஹாஸ்பிட்டல். ஐ ஆம் த ஃபஸ்ட் மேன். ஐ டிரைவ் மை கார். காரை டிரைவ் பண்ணுறதுக்காக வேண்டிய ஒரு சின்ன ரெனால்ட் காரை வாங்கிட்டேன். ஏன்னா எந்த டிரைவரும் இருக்க மாட்டேங்கிட்டான். எத்தனை நேரம் சும்மாவே உட்காந்துட்டுருப்பான், சார் போடுறத எனக்கு மறந்து போக மாட்டிருக்குது, உங்கள் கூட சேர்ந்தானாங்கிறான். சரி நாமளே ஓட்டுவோம், அடித்தா ஆடிக்கிட்டு கடைசிக்கு அப்படியே ஆகட்டும் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி போட்டு. ஏன்னா அதுக்கு முன்னால் வந்து அது பழைய ஹிஸ்ட்ரிங்க, அதை சொன்னாமுன்னா ரொம்ப 10 தடவை விழுந்திருக்கேன் கீழே. நல்ல வேலை எந்த ஃப்ராக்சரும் ஆகலை. இப்போ நம்ம ஒய்ஃப் வந்து எனக்கு ஒரு கம்பேனியன், ஒரு பீகார் காரன் ரூமில் போட்டாங்க. அவன் நான் விழுந்து அவன் என் மேலே விழுந்து, ஏன்னா வெயிட் அவனால் பிடிக்க முடியல. டிவி எல்லாம் உடஞ்சி டேமேஜ். நல்ல வேலை ஒன்றும் ஃப்ராக்சர் ஆகல, காட் சேக். அப்போ அந்த சமயத்தில் வந்து ஐ யூ டேக்கிங் தி கார்டிசான். பின்ன இங்கே வந்த உடனே தான் இவர் கார்டிசானை முதல்ல நிறுத்தினார். முதல்ல கார்டிசானை நிறுத்தினால்தான் எந்த ஒரு ட்ரீட்மெண்ட்டும் வந்து எஃபெக்ட் வரும்னு சொல்லி போட்டு ஹீ ஸ்டாப் த கார்டிசான் ஸ்லோலி. ரெகுலர்லி ஐ கேம் 6 months. முதல்ல வெயிட்டை ரெடியூஸ் பண்ணணும். பின் அவர் சொன்னாங்க ஆல் டைப் ஆஃப் டயட்டுக்கு ஐ அக்செப்டட். ஃபாதர் அண்ட் சன் ரெண்டு பேரும் என்னைய எக்ஸ்பெரிமெண்ட் பண்ணாங்க. நானும் அவர் சொன்னதுக்கெல்லாம் கேட்டுட்டு சொன்னபடியே செஞ்சேன். ஒரு ஸ்டேஜ் வரும்போது 90-91 வரும்பொழுது அப்படியே ஸ்டாக்னெட் ஆகிட்டுது வெயிட். பின்ன அங்கே இருக்கிற மிஷின் பூரா மிஷின்லையும் என்னை யூஸ் பண்ணிட்டாங்க. எல்லா மெடிசனும் சாப்பிட்டேன். முந்தானத்தும் கூட ஒரு மெடிசன், ஒரு புது மிஷின் வந்திருக்குது. ஃபஸ்ட்டு செகண்ட் பேஷண்ட் நான் தான். எவ்வளவுங்க என்ன? 2000ங்க. என்ன பணத்தை எடுத்தேன். இல்லைங்க, எங்களுக்கு அதை செஞ்சு பார்க்குறக்கு பேஷண்ட் இல்லை, நீங்கள் தான் கிடைச்சிங்க, அதனால் இன்றைக்கி ஃப்ரீ. உண்மை தானே? நான் போய் பேசல அப்படின்னாங்க. சரி, பட் ஐ ரிலீவ், பெயின் ரிலீவ் ஆச்சு, வெயிட் ரிலீவ் ஆச்சு. மகேந்திரன் 45 டேஸுக்கு முன்னால் அங்கே வந்திருந்தார். எனக்கு இது தெரியும். ஏன்னா நான் வந்து ஷட்டில் காக் ஆடுவேன், யோகா பண்ணுவேன். எனக்கு ஏன் இந்த சீக்கு வந்ததுன்னு தெரியல. கேட்டால் கர்மான்ட்டான். ஹிந்துவில் சொல்கிறது வியாதி வந்தால் கர்மா. ஐ டோன்ட் இதே சிவசாமி டாக்டருக்கு தான் ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் எடுத்தாங்க. கடைசியில் அவையிலும் கையை போட்டு தான் மகன் பேர சொல்ல வேண்டாம். இன்னொரு டாக்டர்கிட்ட போனேன், இப்படியே பல டாக்டர்களை பார்த்து 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 கடைசியில் மைசன் ஆல்சோ ஏ டாக்டர், மை சன் இன் லா ஆல்சோ டாக்டர். மை சன் என்ன சொல்லுவானா, இப்படித்தான் இருக்கும், இருந்துட்டு போ, வயசாகிட்டதல்ல, பழைய ஆட்டமெல்லாம் ஆட முடியாது. திஸ் இஸ் வாட் ஹீ சே, ஹீஸ் இன் கேஎம்சிஹெச், சிவசம் டாக்டருக்கு தெரியும். சரி அப்பா, நான் அவர்கிட்ட கம்ப்ளைண்ட் பண்ணுவேன், மகனே இப்படி சொல்கிறான் என்ன பண்ணுறதுங்கன்னு. சரின்னு சொல்லி போட்டு ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் எடுத்துட்ருக்கேன். சோஃபார் இன்னும் எடுத்துட்ருக்கேன். இப்போ 45 நாளைக்கு முன்னால் இதில் பார்த்தேன், அப்போ தான் வந்து ஒரு டயட் சொன்னாங்க, 18 ஹவர்ஸ் ஃபாஸ்டிங் இருக்கணும், இன்டர்மிட் ஃபாஸ்டிங். 45 டேஸ் இருந்தாச்சு, ஐ ரெடியூஸ் 11 kg. நவ் ஐ ஆம் 82. அதாவது சட்டை ஒரு 200 ஷர்ட்டு நான் காதி தான் போடுவேன், 200 ஷர்ட் பெருசாக இருந்ததெல்லாம் எல்லாத்துக்கும் தானம் பண்ணிட்டேன். சரி, வேறு ஷர்ட்டை தைச்சது பூரா இப்போ பூரா லூஸ் ஆகிட்டு. Now I am 82. I am also continuing the same thing up to 80. So weight reduction aayittu. Weight reduction aana varagu pura alavukku I am relieved. But irundhalum weight reduction aana varagu everybody say you are very good. Looking very good. பட் ஐ எம் நாட் சாட்டிஸ்ஃபைடு, அது அவருக்கு தெரியும். ஏன்னா இன்னமும் கால் எரிச்சலும் இது இருந்துகிட்டே தான் இருக்குது. அதையும் நான் ரெடி பண்ணி கொடுக்குறேன்னு சொல்லியிருக்கிறாங்க, இன்னும் வந்துட்டு தான் இருக்கேன். அதாவது இப்போ வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 4, 8, 10 ஆச்சு, 10 months. ஐ திங்க் ஐ எம் த சீனியர் மேன், சீனியர் மோஸ்ட், அட்ஸ் கரெக்ட், சீனியர் மோஸ்ட். இப்போ எப்படின்னா, கடைசியாக டாக்டரையே நான் பார்க்குறது இல்லை, நானே போக வேண்டியது, இதுக்கு போக வேண்டியது, இது எடுத்துக்குவேன், வந்து பணத்தை கொடுத்துட்டு போயிட்டு வர்றேன்ட்டு வர வேண்டியது. எதுங்க? ஆ, வந்திருக்குது, முந்தானே வந்தது தான் எனக்கு கொடுத்தாங்களே. அதில் தான் கடைசியில் கண்டுபிடிச்சாரு, காலில் பாதத்தில் தான் நியூரோபதி இஸ் த ப்ராப்ளம் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி. அதுக்கு என்னங்க மிஷினில் போட்டீங்க, நீ பார்த்துட்டீங்க, அதுக்கு ஏதாவது மருந்தை கொடுங்களேன்னு கேட்டேன். இல்லை, நான் சுவிட்சர்லாண்ட் இந்த மாதம் போகிறேன், அங்கே நான் கன்சல்ட் பண்ணிட்டு வந்துட்டு கண்டிப்பாக ரெடி பண்ணிடலாம், ஆல்ரைட் ஐ வில் ஹோப். அதாவது நம்பிக்கையோடு போகணும் ஃபஸ்ட், ரெண்டாவது டாக்டரை நம்பணும், டாக்டரும் நம்மளுக்கு நம்பிக்கை கொடுக்கணும், இருந்தால் தான் போக முடியும். மணி இஸ் மெட்டீரியல். இப்போ இதுவரைக்கும் நான் செஞ்ச ஸ்பெண்ட் மணி பார்த்தோம்னா 2 times பைபாஸ் பண்ணி வந்திருக்கலாம். பட் மணி இஸ் மெட்டீரியல் டு மீ. பட் வந்து க்யூர் ஆகணும். அதில் வந்து மற்றதில் வந்து மற்ற லாட் ஆஃப் இது இருக்குது, லோபதி இருக்குது, ஆயுர்வேதிக் இருக்குது, இந்த எத்தனையோ தெரப்பீஸ் எல்லாம் இருக்குது, இன்றைக்கி இல்லைன்னு சொல்லலை. பட் இல்லை, அதில் ஆகலைங்கும் போது இதை வந்து இன்றைக்கி இதை ரெகனைஸ் பண்ண மாட்டேங்கிறாங்க, தெரிய மாட்டேங்குது. நான் நிறைய பேஷண்ட்டை பார்க்குறேன், கேன்சர் பேஷண்ட் நிறைய வர்றாங்க. பட் என்னென்னா எல்லாம் வந்து ஃபைனல் ஸ்டேஜில் தான் வர்றாங்க, கையை விட்ட ஸ்டேஜில் தான் இங்கே வர்றாங்க. ஒருத்தர் சொல்லி கையை விட்ட பிறகு சொல்கிறாங்க, பொள்ளாச்சியில் இந்த மாதிரி ஒன்று இருக்குது, அங்கே போங்க. இது என் கண், ஏன்னா ஐ வில் இன்ட்ராக்ட் வித் தம், ஏன்னா எனக்கு ஊசி போட்டு உட்கார வச்சுருவாங்க. அதாவது 9:30 போனால் என்னை விடுறது எத்தனை மணின்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 12:30, 1:30, 2:30, சில சமயத்தில் 3:30 வரைக்கும் ஐ வில் பி தேர், போயிட்டே இருக்கேன். இப்போ நீங்கள் சொன்ன ஒரு போட்ட தெரப்பு எல்லாமே போட்டேன் நான். 3:30 வரைக்கெல்லாம் இருந்திருக்கேன், 4 hours 5 hours. அப்போ என்ன பண்ணுறதுன்னா பக்கத்தால் ஒருத்தருப்பார் உட்காந்து பேசுறது. பேசும்போது கேட்டோம்னா எல்லாம் வந்திருக்கிற எல்லாம் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ஃபைனல் ஸ்டேஜில் தான் வர்றாங்க. ஏனுங்க ஃபைனல் ஸ்டேஜில் வர்றீங்களே, ஏன்னா இது ஓசோன் போட்டால் வலி இல்லாமல் இருக்குதுங்க. வீட்டில் வலிக்குது வலிக்குதுன்னு அவர் கத்துற கற்று தாங்க முடியல. ஓசோன் போடும்போது பெயினாக இல்லாமல் இருக்குது, அதுக்காக வேண்டி வந்திருக்கேன்னாங்க. அப்படிங்களா? எனக்கு இந்த கேன்சரு இதெல்லாம் நீங்கள் கிளாஸ் எடுத்ததுக்கு அப்புறம்தான் தெரியுது. செல்லு இதெல்லாம் என்ன இந்த இந்த என்ன பண்ணதுங்கிறத பற்றி எனக்கு தெரியுது, அந்த அளவுக்கு தெரியறது இல்லை. இட்ஸ் எ லேமேன், ஐ எம் ஆல்சோ எ புவர் ஃபார்மர். அதான் நேற்று ஒரு விசேஷத்துக்கு போகும்போது ஆனவராயர் எனக்கு மச்சான், சேர்மனுக்கு மச்சான் தான் முதல்ல பார்த்ததையுமே சொன்னார், என்னங்க மாணிக்க உங்களை தான் சொல்லிகிட்டே இருக்காரு, உங்களை வச்சே தான் உங்கள் உங்கள் பேரை சொல்லிக்கிட்டே தான் அவர் அங்கே கிளினிக்கே நடத்துவாராட்டிருக்குதுன்னாரு. நல்ல வேலைங்க என்ன படத்தை மாட்டாமல் இருக்காங்கன்னு சொன்னேன். அதனால் இன்னமும் சரியாகல. ஐ திங்க் ஐ ஹோப் ஏ ஆல்சோ கன்சிடர் மகேந்திரன், அருள், சிபி. அதாவது ஒரு ஃபேமிலி கணக்காக தான் இந்த 12 months போயிட்டுருக்கேன். இன்னும் எத்தனை நாள் போகணும்னு தெரியல. என்னை வேகத்தில் ரிலீவ் பண்ணி விடுங்க. தட்ஸ் ஆல் ஐ ரிக்வெஸ்ட் யூ. பட் இட் இஸ் எ வெரி குட் மெடிசின். எல்லோரும் இதை பேஷண்ட் அதாவது ஏர்லி ஸ்டேஜில் வரணும். ஐ எம் ஆல்சோ வெரி லேட் ஸ்டேஜ். ஏர்லி ஸ்டேஜில் வந்திருந்தேன்னா இந்தளவுக்கு நான் சஃபர் பண்ணியிருக்க முடியாது. With this, thank you.
Hello. I can summarize what Dean Dr. Ramlingam said. The pharmaceuticals are a mafia. Whatever is going to destroy them will be banned. I was practicing ozone for almost 10 years in Malaysia. The Minister of Health is a good friend of mine. I delivered 4 of his children. 6 years after I treated my wife, he visits me. His father is a good friend of mine. And he came and told me, you are doing a fantastic job, carry on. And when they brought out the statistics that chemotherapy sales fell 40% in Malaysia, after I started training, I mean, I felt that God has rewarded me by my wife being in remission for almost 4-5 years, 10 years. So I said, I'm not interested in money. God has given me enough, so let's. In every ozone center I started several, I always told them, one bed should be for charity for people who can't afford. So the pharmaceuticals, when the pharmaceuticals interfere, it is simple. It is because they want to make money. And it is, I have published several times, tried to publish all this. None of the journals would accept it because it is not conventional medicine. Once it was accepted by one city in India, me and my wife went there. They even paid for my ticket. And 2 days before, the organizing chairman came and told me, Dr. Mahendran, sorry about it. Since this is not part of conventional medicine, we won't allow you to present it. So basically, I'll go one step further, which I heard, but I've got no proof, that they even induce diseases to sell medicine. That is the extent the pharmaceutical. The FDA is controlled by the pharmaceuticals. The government is controlled by the pharmaceuticals. The profit they make is not 20%, 30%. What cost 2 rupees, it sold for 100 or 150 rupees. And you see the oncologist, we run around operating, delivering. They sit down and make much more money than what all of us put together do. And that is the curse of the pharmaceuticals, and they're such a strong mafia. To be honest with you, my wife was in intensive care for 23 days in a hospital in the US, and I was with her, and I convinced 3 or 4 physicians what it does, but they wouldn't. I took an ozone generator, they wouldn't allow me to use it, and she had a viral pneumonia. And 2 or 3 of them told me, if you want to take the pharmaceuticals ahead, we'll assist you. And when we were discussing this, my 2 close friends in America said, don't even try, because they can bump you off.
Actually, I met Dr. Rajagopal of Ramakrishna Hospital 2 days back. And I found that they have, for that back pain, they have suggested me that Lyrica medicine and something else. I bought it from generic medicine store. Whereas the Lyrica, the cost is 85 rupees. The same contents of alternative pregabalin is just 2 rupees 25 paise. That is more than 5,000 to 7,000 multiply rate is for Lyrica. Shall we take, after consulting from the doctor, the same pregabalin M for the 75 mg, I bought it from generic store in Pollachi. That is giving the same effect for me for the last 2 or 3 days. Is it okay, sir, buying that generic medicines?
No, there are several generic medication, and I don't know in India.
Actually, India lo vandhunga penna irukna, the government has passed a law that generic medicines must be sold. So neenga vandha the branded medicine kum generic medicine kum vidyasame kedaiyadhu. So I don't think there's any problem in taking a generic, because they also now will, if you go to the website of government of India, they'll give
yes,
you the
I
generic
have
right
seen
so
it.
So that is actually government of India supporting to reduce the cost of medication for people. So generic medicine is perfectly okay as far as India is concerned.
Pfizer manufacturing Lyrica is 85 rupees. That Torrent and Cipla, they are giving for 2 rupees 55 paise. The same government manufacturing medicine is 2 rupees 25 paise. Whereas 40 times increase to that companies. People have to accept for that buying generic medicines, I
That's
think.
That's right. Government of India has allowed generic drugs, so we should look at any medication. Please look at the formulation. If we can buy generic, you will save a lot of money.
Nobody is knowing about it, because if they go in Google, they can know more about. Sir, we Lions are conducting more diabetic camps. At a time, we have conducted 204 camps for 60,834 patients with all records in Pollachi, Coimbatore, Tirupur. Out of that, we could see 5% of new cases. And the amputation cases also, we could see more from more persons. What kind of treatment you are having for that gangrene having patients?
That's what I told you about how ozone works on gangrene. And when it comes to pain, there are 2 kinds of pain. You are talking about pain medication. One is inflammation and the other is ischemic. Inflammation is something, can infection, injury, it's all inflammation. And if you have got pain, you don't want to take, you can do prolozone. This is just injecting ozone into the muscle. That reduces inflammation. The biochemical marker of inflammation is C-reactive protein. And there are a lot of publications saying that after ozone, the C-reactive protein drops. That means your inflammation subsides. So if I have pain, I won't take allopathic medication. I am against taking allopathic medication. I prefer herbal or Ayurvedic medicine because of this reason. Any allopathic medication is treated by the liver as a foreign body. So the liver actually is stressed to bring out. So only 50% or less is. So I would suggest something that is natural for relief of pain. If you want, you can try prolozone. They just inject in your muscle and that reduces the inflammation. And don't expect it to go immediately. Like Mr. Senthil was telling, his problem takes a while. Because this issue had come, what has happened over many years cannot go off like a switch. It also has to take its time to come down. and you are very young and you are responsibly fast. So you, if you believe in ozone, prolozone, that's just injecting at the site of the muscle, which is a very simple procedure. And that's what I would suggest. So diabetes, of course, you got to control. You should know that diabetes, the medicine only works 50%. The other is done by diet and exercise. So unless you can combine all that, but unfortunately when diabetics at that stage, they are unable to exercise. So if they are unable to exercise, you all have to control diet. I just advised a diet last time, casually I spoke to him, and he has lost 10 kilos and he's looking much better. So I would always, after being a very, very passionate allopathic doctor, I have completely moved out of segment after seeing that I have practiced medicine for half a century, 50 years, after which I realized that I am on the wrong track till I moved to ozone. Thank you.
Good evening. Good evening, sir. My name is Dharani Rangnathan. Thank you for the learning today. I learned quite a bit. I'm here because I just want to clarify on something. My mother's been an arthritis patient for the last 28 years. And about 2.5 years back, we found out that both the knees are completely been touching each other. And now there's debris formed. So there's small bone fragments which flares up her pain and also causes inflammation. Since she's thin, she's been managing around. She walks around, she's fine. She even, drags her body around. And they also found out that because of adjusting and walking around, both her knees, rib cage is slowly deteriorating as well. And her right shoulder is also, the bones are touching. So her toes are also a little deformed because of arthritis over the period of years. Obviously, over the last 28 years, she's tried various kinds of treatments and medicines. Doctors recommended both her knees to be replaced. Of course, I've read about ozone, and also a few friends have recommended. How do you think ozone could help her now? And do you recommend going for knee surgery and then again doing ozone? What would you recommend?
How old is she now?
She's about 66, 67.
Has she had diabetes or hypertension?
Nothing.
Nothing at all?
Nothing.
No, replacement is fine, but the biggest asset is she's not heavy.
Yeah, and she's thin, yeah.
She's not heavy. Yeah. You see, I have been having a bad shoulder for almost 12, 13 years. I played tennis, it hurts, but I was always on ozone. After going to America, this gave me problems and I had to do a shoulder replacement. But ozone, for those, has she been on methotrexate for her? You said rheumatoid arthritis.
Yeah, I mean she tries maximum not to take painkiller basically.
Yeah, but I have had young patients with knee problems who are on methotrexate, and over 2 to 2.5 years we bring down the methotrexate, and we monitor this by ESR, any autoimmune disease, and ozone, once you get the baseline, you just have to do it as maintenance once a month, but you have to do that for the rest of your life.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, doctor. I'm Kalyan Ganeshan. My age is 57. I have recently been diagnosed of aortic stenosis, only just 6-8 weeks back. Initially, I was given by Dr. Arul few vitamin C and other IVs, and even few times ozone IV. But when hyperbaric was given for the first time, that night I had a terrible attack, you know, like in the sense my lungs almost got seized off, like suddenly. I started having severe cough, and slowly it was choking me. To the extent, finally, I went to see my wife's face. I thought maybe now I'm going to go. Before that, at least one last time I must see her. So that was the situation I had. So next day, I went back to the doctor. Doctor told me, okay, there could be some reaction. We will stop this ozone treatment for the time being. and we'll continue with the other treatments. So since last 5-6 weeks I have been continuing with other treatment. In the meanwhile, my curiosity got me off, like in the sense, in these 5-6 weeks I never had any problem. So I was wondering whether it was really ozone which triggered this problem, or really I imagined. So again I requested the doctor to give me one more ozone after coming to Pollachi. Just last week, one more time, I got this IV done. Again the same night I had a similar attack, but then this time I was better prepared, because I know when this attack comes, what all I should do, how I should control myself. And but somehow I managed it. But in the last 5-6 days, since the time that is given, till date I'm not yet fully recovered. Even now as I am talking to you, I'm feeling slightly, there is a congestion in me. And so I want to know, is there any link between ozone and this kind of adverse attack?
What were the symptoms you started with? How did you have this problem? How do you recognize a medical? What were the symptoms?
Doctor, the first thing is, first time when I had it was it all started with some violent cough.
Okay.
I was about to go to sleep, so I was preparing myself. Then I had a few cough, so I took it very light, and then it went on and on, some 6-8 times, 10 times.
Yeah.
But each time that cough was getting little more, intensive, little more painful, or some way physically affecting me.
Yeah.
So then when I finished coughing, I realized I am unable to breathe properly.
I see, okay.
So thereafter that breathing problem continued.
Yeah.
Once I felt a little breathing problem, maybe, I am not sure, whether I created it or body does it, I started breathing very fast.
I see.
At times I felt it was very sickening, The attack started around 11 o'clock.
I see.
Went on up to early morning 5:30.
No, whenever we have breathing problems, it's only a reflex. We try to breathe too frequently to compensate.
Yeah.
From what I can see, oxygen cannot do much, but it is probably some of the toxins that you're having in yourself that is coming out, maybe in the form of allergy or whatever, is sort of doing this. I can't see how oxygen can give you breathing problems, because that gives you more oxygen, reduces your work of the lungs. So if you ask me, there are some people who react badly to oxygen, and this is because some toxin that is being dislodged in you, you can form an allergy to that.
Okay.
And when you get a mild anaphylaxis, that gives you breathing problems.
Okay.
So if you're afraid of that, probably they can give you some antihistamines or even a short-term steroid before giving this. And that might, what you can do is just take a short-term steroid and do this, and probably that might help. Thank you.
I'm so happy that, doctor, what you told exactly, that is what Dr. Allu has been telling me. Rather, his version now gets vindicated. I should have started with in a proper manner, but I was in a hurry because so many people are there. I wanted to shoot my question first. First of all, I want to thank you for the wonderful presentation you have given. It was a flawless presentation. It was like some 300-piece harmony, like so beautifully you have presented. I am really very happy. It was very informative. And I also have two more small questions, doctor. One, I understand your very emotionally charged up reason for what made you to look at this option. I fully empathize with you, but it shows what a metal you are made of, that such adversity you turned into such a wonderful lifetime mission. I want to congratulate you for such a approach to this. It is a very inspiring thing for me. And of your level of academic achievement, emotional alone couldn't have been the singular reason why you had 5 decades of experience, you would just disown and walk into some unknown territory. What was the professional level merit you have seen in this?
You see, I learned ozone therapy not to make a living. I learned ozone therapy to save my wife. It's a totally different scenario. And if my wife had not had cancer, I'll be still teaching obstetrics and gynecology. It was just a click that happens and turns you a way around. and then only you look at things which you have never seen before. You see, I had an honor of doing my doctorate in one of the best universities in the world. And even there, they tell us what you do is the best and only thing. So to deviate from what you have been taught, you need a triggering factor. And that triggering factor, unfortunately, was my wife being diagnosed with cancer. Okay. So I am more passionate about it because I learned it to treat my wife.
One more question, doctor. I have also read quite a bit, almost 600-800 pages related to this field, just to know what is the field I'm entering into to get my treatment. I also fully understand this pharma mafia is very, very strong. Maybe possibly they are much more stronger than ISIS. But that is a known fact now. If this particular kind of treatment has to survive, what is the way out to break it? Is it going to be only a whispering kind of field? Or one day Dr. Arul can go onto any top TV or on the best electronic or print media to go and openly say, this can be treated, gangrene can be recovered, and cancer can be cured. Why should we not be able to officially claim? Why should it be always a whisper?
Yeah, officially it is through the government that has to be done. You see, I am so tied now. Something I learned with so much of passion, I am unable to practice because I am in the US. But still, I have presented this in several seminars, and I don't think even the pharmaceuticals can hold it for too long. Now there are a few centers opening up in the US and Europe, virtually because of Germany, it's available in most places. Italy, Germany. In fact, I am told in Germany, this is going to become part of the regular MBBS curriculum.
Wow.
Because Germans, you know, I was surprised because, you see, when you even go to politics, Vietnam, South, Korea, South, North, there is always this disparity. But within 9 months of breaking of the Berlin Wall, nobody talks of East Germany or West Germany. There is no corruption. That is why that nation today can bail out other countries. So they can't hold this for too long. And to be honest with you, in Liberia, when the Ebola broke out, David Schumacher is a big proponent of ozone.
Oh.
He is in coma. The wife sent 6 machines there. They were all set up. And then the drug company intervened, packed up and sent them back. So they don't mind losing lives as long as they don't get evidence that it works against the virus. As I told you, I've got so many. I'll give you another example of a very good friend of mine, a well-off politician, Chinese. His daughter delivered, and after 1 week, she was diagnosed of dengue, viral fever, which is rampant in Malaysia. So he said, what do I do? I said, look here, she's in the ICU, the same hospital I'm working. I can't do much. He said, if I bring her, can you? Okay, I said, and she said, okay, 3 o'clock, he brought her, I gave her one ozone. Then after 2 days, her platelets went up, she came for the second one. Then I asked him, how did you manage to take her? In dengue, they don't do anything. They just give you normal saline and control your fever. That's all they do. He said, no, I'm taking her for some prayers, and they couldn't refuse. So you have to find backdoor ways of getting what you want to, because the system doesn't allow it.
Sir, please permit me one footnote. Rather, I should rephrase. It is not a footnote. It is a kind of a preface. I wanted to tell in front of the August crowd, you know, having remained here almost for a fortnight, I've seen this facility. So I wanted to, from the core of my heart, congratulate Dr. Mahalingam for building up such a wonderful edifice. And having remained 15 days, I've also traveled about 120 countries, having gone to some of the finest labs in the world and manufacturing facilities. Although it is not in size gigantic, but a very self-contained, completely well-balanced one. Every inch you can see how passionate he has put his heart behind and developed this facility. So I'm sure maybe his father must be very happy wherever he is for doing such a wonderful this for the social cause. Similarly, I also want to, in front of everybody, admit Dr. Arul has been so helpful, so wonderful, you know. For me, he is not a practitioner, medical practitioner. I myself, I consider him as a holistic healer, you know. not just a medicine alone, he treated me. In my life turned topsy-turvy. Just one fine day, when I came to him, I was under the impression on my left hand he is going to put on syringe, on right hand one he is going to put, and then it is going to get ozonated. In 2 days I am going to just walk back and go. I never know this stenosis was hiding inside me. And then this attack came. I really, really, first time I saw the horrible face of death in front of me. You know, physically feeling is different. So, almost that day I started rewinding my whole life and felt these are the few missing end I have left in my life. I should finish it quickly because God knows who, how long I am going to be. Next day, the way he gave me the encouragement, you know, it was superb. I was put back to my platform. You know, once again, I am much more confident. That is how myself and I also brought my wife for this treatment. And he has got a fantastic team, doctors and support team. So I thought I should accept this and recognize this in front of everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much.
After listening to you, I feel I must apply for a job to Dr. Manikam and Dr. Arul. But I am already 80. I wonder if they employ me.
Thank you, sir. As a token of love and gratitude, we request Dr. M.